We have a good lineup today. We want to focus today on the Thai-US relations in a changing regional environment. Before I introduce the speakers, I want to introduce our keynote speaker who will be here just until 9:30, so we have to make efficient use of time. She doesn't need an introduction. Ambassador Christy Kenny will address the contours of Thai-US relations. Ambassador Kenny has been ambassador in Ecuador and Philippines. She has a very busy schedule today. She was a political science graduate from Clemson and then Latin American studies in Tulane for her master's degree. She is a social activist in a way with her social media work. And today I know that Ambassador Kenny, you have to leave for a very busy day. And I know that you'll probably tell us about the highlights, the dynamics of Thai-US relations, but I have to prompt you a little bit that, and prod you a little bit to address the more challenging questions and issues about Thai-US relations. There's a sense that, you know, it's not, we're not going to break off or part ways, but there's a sense of drift. There's a sense of a lack of thrust in the relationship, and people have seen that Ying Luck has been to China, even as recently as last week, and making a lot of overtures to China and even Russia. But the U.S., Ying Luck has not visited yet. So the visit is a kind of a thorny issue for Thai-U.S. Watchers, because the Vietnamese has been there, the Vietnamese leader, Malaysian leader has been there, but not the Thai yet. And we are the oldest friend of the U.S. In Asia, 180 years. There's also other issues. I mean, trade investment, you know, we have very rich military-to-military component in the bilateral alliance. Thailand is one of the five treaty allies of the U.S. in Asia. There's a sense that not only a lack of thrust in the bilateral relationship, but also that the U.S. under Obama too may be tempted to take its eye off the ball, American speak, because of its focus now in the Middle East and the Syrian crisis and so on. So the region is changing a lot. China, US, lots of things to discuss. We'll wait to hear from you. And Ambassador Kenny has been kind enough to accept to field a few questions or comments. My boss, my dean, Professor Supachai Yawarpapat, will first provide some welcoming remarks. I'm so sorry.
Excellency Ambassador Christy Kenny, the United States Ambassador to Thailand, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it is again my honor to come here to welcome all of you to this really important public forum on the Thailand and the United States after 180 years, a changing alliance in a changing Southeast Asia. And particularly, I would like to not so often that we have a chance to welcome the United States Ambassador to Thailand here. So thank you very much to honor us. And I know that everyone here in this room would like to hear from you and also to hear from the speaker. So I will end my remark now and welcome all of you so that they will have a chance to listen to your ambassador. Thank you very much.
Thank you. ขอบคุณมากครับอาจารย์ครับ Ambassador Kenny.
Hi, good morning everybody. I want to thank Dr. Supachai for welcoming us here today and Ajahn Thitinan as well. Also, it's a great pleasure for me to be on the podium with good friends and colleagues. Ajahn Thitipol is the first academic I met in Thailand when I was out in Ubon Ratchathani. Of course, John Brandon is a longtime friend and friend of Thailand and America Thai Watcher Dean. And Khun Gawi is another old friend whose views are always colorful, lively, and always important. So thanks for joining all of us here today. I'm going to talk very briefly about the U.S.-Thai relationship kind of then and now, and then I'd like to lay out what I see as opportunities for the United States and Thailand in today's changing world, and then a few challenges that I hope you all will look at and examine in the course of the morning. So Dr. Tittinen has given me a little prodding, and I'm going to give you all just a little bit back. So let me start by taking you all back 180 years. Thailand and the U.S. signed the Treaty of Amity and Commerce, with really business and commercial relationships as the heart and the hub of the beginning of our relationship. That's still a very, very strong aspect of our partnership today. We have one of the world's largest chambers of commerce for the American business anywhere. We have companies, large and small, here. I know we have some of the representatives here with us today, but just last week I was at General Motors, state-of-the-art factory, producing engines, Chevy Colorados, for exports throughout the region. So business was the beginning, as in so many relationships, commerce, and it still remains a really strong aspect. Over the past 180 years, we also added an important dimension in security to our partnership as another strong pole in the tent, if you will. And of course, not only were we together during conflicts, but now we've added a lot of important dimensions, humanitarian assistance through tsunamis, typhoons, cyclones. We've added joint peacekeeping work, places as far away as Darfur, anti-piracy missions off the Horn of Somalia. But over the last 50 years, I'd argue too, we've become much more multidimensional. Our partnership has added, for example, an important component in health partnership. We're working together on vaccines against HIV/AIDS, dengue. We're working on drug-resistant malaria, tuberculosis, and we've added a lot of pieces in 50 years. And I think that has brought us to a very rounded friendship that expands in many, many directions. While we've been changing and making our partnership more multidimensional, as today's title suggests, Southeast Asia has been changing too. You notice that, you know, 50 years ago, Bangkok was not the most visited city in the world. Today it is. Today we have nations as a part of Southeast Asia that didn't exist 10, 15 years ago. East Timor, we see Burma emerging from decades of isolation. So there are a lot of changes going on. And it's a great time to talk about that because the calendar is in our favor. Over the next several months, of course, the series of big signature ASEAN meetings that now draw not only leaders to ASEAN meetings, but other nations come join. We have the APEC meetings, again, another gathering in Asia that draws world leaders from all over. And we also have the East Asia Summit, another forum. So over the next several months, you're going to see a lot of global and regional leaders converging on Southeast Asia. And we're also a year and a half away from a very potentially exciting development, and that is the ASEAN Economic Community. So, you know, there are big changes and issues going on that didn't happen 10 years ago. Hard to predict what will happen tomorrow. And if you look also at Thailand, we sit here in Thailand. As I said, 10 years ago, Bangkok wasn't the most visited city in the world. Today, Bangkok is big, bustling, modern, tech-savvy, wired. You know, there are changes going on throughout Southeast Asia that I think are exciting. I think there are big opportunities for the United States and Thailand in this changing framework. And I'm just going to outline a couple of the areas where I think we can really productively move our partnership and friendship into this changing space. One is a partnership to help nations in Southeast Asia that are changing but not yet achieved the level of development we see in Thailand. So, for example, we have a great partnership that's new, just signed when President Obama was here, where our two countries will work together to help Burma develop their capacity to combat malaria. You know, Thailand was once a recipient of U.S. development assistance. Now they're a donor nation and a partner with us. We're using that same partnership to train veterinarians in Laos, help them build their capacity to combat the kind of diseases that, of course, we all know move from animals to people. Our law enforcement partnership. Thailand and the United States co-host the International Law Enforcement Academy here in Bangkok. We train thousands of police from across the region, as far north as China, as far south as using Australian instructors. And we train them in everything from traditional policing work, anti-narcotics work, to some of today's crimes, anti-wildlife trafficking, trafficking in persons. Last year, we hosted for the first time a training course for women law enforcement officers throughout the region. So when you're training together 5,000-6,000 police officers a year, you know, that's a good use of our partnership in a dynamic and changing region. You could also look at our partnership, I think, emerging and growing in environment and conservation. We are about to sign, I'm previewing this, so please don't quote me on it until it is, but a partnership with the Smithsonian and Thailand for research in endangered species. We'll start with clouded leopards, move on to others. We jointly hosted about 6 months ago training for rangers who work in tiger ranges from across a huge swath of Asia to include also Nepal, Bangladesh. So these are ways our partnership together, we can bring people in to work on issues that we maybe didn't even think about years ago, but it's a great way we can combine on the security side as well. Our once bilateral Cobra Gold annual exercise is now the world's largest multinational military exercise. We have participants and observers from nearly two dozen nations. And a lot of you don't get the chance to get out and see. I joined the last couple of years, and some of my colleagues in the room have as well, to watch our military with badges from countries from Indonesia, Malaysia, Singapore, Japan, offering medical clinics, sharing ideas. You know, that's a great way that our partnership has brought in so many others. We have challenges. The changing Southeast Asia landscape, the changing global landscape, has brought what I would consider some global challenges to our door and to our partnership. Some of these issues involve the dark side of globalization, trafficking in persons, illegal wildlife trafficking, pandemic health threats that move from nation to nation. You know, we also see the growth of new emerging powers and countries. We didn't, when this partnership began, envision the extraordinary growth of China, India, the fact that Indonesia would now be a thriving democracy. We didn't even think about Mongolia. We didn't have Burma on the screen. We didn't have East Timor. So there's a lot of growth and energy in the region. And I think that means for Thailand and the US, we're all drawn into multiple partnerships, multiple friends. This is a good thing, but I think our challenge is obviously keeping the partnership fresh, focused, and relevant, you know, not losing sight of an old friendship, even as new friendships and new regional architecture has emerged. As I said earlier, if you look at ASEAN, grown tremendously in strength and importance, and that's coming even stronger as we approach the AEC. You look at our business relationships. Those go across borders as you see people growing and businesses have become more multinational. If you go to an American business here, you're likely to see people from around the globe as its executives and staff. So I think the challenge is keeping that friendship relevant, focused, and alive, but not inhibiting the growth of many other partnerships and friendships, not inhibiting the important growth and strength of the regional architecture. So I want to offer a couple of ways I think we could move forward, and then I'd love to hear from you all and take some questions. First of all, I think it's important that our partnership, as it has done over the years, stay changing, stay flexible, stay ready to adapt to new circumstances, new issues, new friends, new adventures, and new challenges. That means our partnership cannot just be government to government. Now, government to government, I represent a government. Obviously, I like to think that what we do is important and relevant, and it is. Obviously, we're thrilled to welcome President Obama here, and he's invited the Prime Minister to go, but we still haven't found a date, but we will. But, you know, we were thrilled to welcome Secretaries of State, Secretaries of Defense, the Secretary of Health for the United States was just here, the Deputy Secretary of Energy comes next week. But again, it's got to be more than just governments. Our relationship needs to include parliamentarians as well, and exchanges between them. The past couple of weeks, we've had Thai American Congresswoman Tammy Duckworth out here, and thank you, Ajahn, for hosting her here. We also had the chairman of the House Foreign Affairs Committee, Congressman Royce, here. But we need to see more of that, and we need to see Thai parliamentarians going to Washington and meeting with their counterparts. We need to see contacts between mayors. The governor of Bangkok has been to Washington, been to New York, talked to our mayors, but we need to see that from more around the country. We need to link up our officials, not just executive government, but across. We need to do the same with business. We've hosted out here some very large American business delegations this year, and we have another one coming this month on energy. But we haven't seen a lot of Thai business delegations heading to the United States, and we need to encourage that. Those relationships are important, they're beneficial to both of us, and we need to use our influence, our authority, to make sure those links happen. Academics, NGOs, universities need to link up, need to talk to each other, need to go. And some of the people at this table I know do travel often to and from Washington, and we're thrilled to welcome John Brandon back to Thailand as well, but we need to see more of that. There needs to be that kind of robust dialogue, whether it's in forums elsewhere in the world or traveling back and forth, that really keeps the flow of ideas from outside government going. And finally, I'd argue to you, we need to see and encourage and expand our people-to-people relations. We have good and robust tourism back and forth. The numbers are going up. The numbers are going up on Thai students who study in the United States and U.S. students who study out here. But we need to do everything we can to encourage that robust people-to-people friendship to stay strong. So I want to close by saying there are those who say the United States excuse me, doesn't care about Thailand. Why does Thailand matter? And I'm going to offer you a very simple explanation. Not only is Thailand our oldest friend in the region, our oldest treaty ally in Asia, but look at the geography and look at the world around Thailand. Thailand sits at the center of what will become one of the world's largest trading blocks, the ASEAN Economic Community. Thailand is at the center, bordering a nation that's emerging from years of isolation. To the south sits Indonesia, currently the world's largest Muslim nation and a growing economic powerhouse. If you want to look at what sits to the north, you have China, a world's emerging power whose economic growth has been breathtaking, frankly. You know, Thailand's location, strategic hub, connectivity make Thailand relevant not only to America, but to everyone else. So I want to thank you all, and I'd be very honored to take questions, provided you do it within 6 minutes. I'd stay longer, but I have been promised my staff I'll be out, and I will be at the meeting at 10, having collected my law enforcement delegation who's here visiting. So please.
Okay, no summary here. Questions? I think we'll take just a couple of questions if there are any. If I may kind of say that what you have described is more a normal partnership, but you know, it's a normal partnership with a lot of nuances, very dense ties, not the old indispensable alliance that perhaps we saw during the Cold War. So the texture, the tone has changed, but still very good, still very good. We have time for one or two questions.
I'm Dr. Ponchai from Bulapa University. Thank you so much for your presentation here. I'm very pleased to learn on that. I myself interested in learning on American history. Let's go to my question. My question is that what is US strategic viewpoint looking forward to Thailand in comparison with Middle East situation at this moment. Thank you.
Are aware particularly of the issue regarding Syria. So let me just update you on where we are and share with you also that I have been in very, very close touch, obviously, with the Thai foreign minister so that he knows what we're thinking and where we are. But for those of you who missed it, this is an issue about chemical weapons, a weapon that was banned by the international community about 100 years ago. There is strong evidence that this was used in Syria to kill and slaughter thousands of people. And I think the question now for all of us is how do we respond? How, as an international community, do we look at these developments in Syria, and what path is there to take? President Obama has said he believes we must respond, that you cannot allow a nation to use a weapon we have all banned without some sort of penalty or punishment. He has chosen to consult the United States Congress. I think he said he viewed it not as a must-do, but important given his constitutional democracy role. But we'll see where the United States Congress comes out. The president is also going to be speaking tonight while we sleep about this issue. He'll be doing a lot of media interviews, so we'll see. But one of the things we've been doing is sharing with Thailand our views, our thoughts, our evidence. But Thailand and others will make their own choices. So Thailand continues, again, Jay talks about a dense partnership. You know, these are issues we talk about together. You know, when President Obama was out here, he had the great honor of a call with His Majesty the King. And one of the issues His Majesty raised was, what do you see the prospects for peace in Afghanistan? And the two of them had a good conversation on it. You know, again, Thailand may choose or not to support the view that the use of chemical weapons is appalling, and Thailand and many others have said that. But they may or may not choose a path we think is important to show that. But what I like about it is the fact that we have these ongoing dialogues with the Thai, that we can talk about these issues candidly, openly. To my mind, that's a sign of a good partnership and a good friendship. And you know, these are tough issues. Really, how do you respond when a nation uses chemical weapons, a weapon that has been banned by the entire international community? Interesting to see. But I thank you very much for raising that issue, because it is important. And what's important to us is to tell the Thai where we're thinking and hear back from them their views.
So this, you very rightly mentioned the changing landscape. You did mention of the habitat, the countries, but what about the changing spatial habitat, for instance, the issues on water, the issues on energy and waste? These are transboundary issues. I think both US as well as Thailand are a hub on changing habitats. And so what's your take on that for the future?
I remember I interviewed you last year before President Obama won the second term in presidential election. I'm just wondering what's the possibility that he could have come to Thailand again this year to attend East Asia Summit, or what's the possibility?
We completely agree with you, and I didn't go into detail on all of the partnerships, but in terms of issues like water, clean energy, this is not only a partnership that the Thai government and the US government look at, and we've jointly done some research, for example, I think as you're probably aware, on the Mekong Basin, but you know, our American businesses are also strong proponents of green energy. We see that as an issue of potential investment for America here, and we'd love to learn some of that from the Thai. And as I said, we have the US Deputy Secretary of Energy coming out here precisely to talk clean energy in 2 weeks. And then we're also bringing a business delegation of US clean energy executives out. So, you know, we completely agree with you in every way. These are important issues. And Thailand and the United States, again, our research ability together, I think offers a lot of promise for other countries. These are tough issues. Water management makes politics look easy. So, you know, thank you for raising that. You're absolutely right. Kunata, thank you very much. Great to see you. As you all know, President Obama was here last November. We do know that he will be traveling to several events in Asia coming up. We don't have the full schedule. What we know is that he will be, of course, attending the East Asia Summit, the expanded ASEAN meetings, the APEC meetings, as well as chairing a global entrepreneurship summit in Malaysia. And there will be Thai entrepreneurs joining that. We don't have details if he will visit any additional countries or not at this time. You may remember when he was here, he said he wanted to bring his wife and the girls back. So we'll see if and when that can happen.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Kenny, for taking time from your packed day to be with us today. Thank you. Has kindly made some time to lead us off, to kick off the day, I think. What she described to me really reinforces the view that the U.S.-Thai relationship, the bilateral relationship, is really an alliance. And it's not what it used to be. It's still very important, and we have a number of efforts, workshops, conferences, organizations whose task has been to try to, quote-unquote, revitalize the U.S.-Thai relationship. So it's not a dead relationship, but it's just not what it used to be. And from what the ambassador described, it's more like it's a normal relationship. It has a lot of exchanges. It's not as special as it used to be. In the meantime, I think Thailand also has looked to other power centers, not just the U.S. And the U.S. has looked to other partners in Southeast Asia, especially Indonesia, Singapore, Malaysia, Vietnam, and so on, and not just Thailand, like in the past, and during the Cold War. So now, let us continue with our speakers. We have three speakers. We'll run until 11:30. First, Kunkawi Jongkitawon, and then followed by John Brandon, and then Chan Titipon Pakti Yunit. You have their bios already, so I won't go into some long details about their background. But for Kunkawi, I would just say that he is a senior fellow at ISIS. He has been a very long time, leading commentator, analyst on regional affairs. He's an expert on ASEAN. He can write and speak about many, many issues. And he's going to the U.S. Very soon, in a few days, to address this particular subject matter. So, Kunkawi.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Titinant. Good morning, everyone, and goodbye to Thai-U.S. relation. The ambassador spoke about Thai-U.S. relation that I'm not really familiar, but she has made a very good point that Thailand is indeed a development partner, not a strategic partner that you and I thought about. So Thailand has now a new status as a development partner of United States. So let us sit down and just look at the past 60 years. The reason I have to take you back into the past because Thai and US have dwelt on the past. In the last commemoration of 180 years in May, a lot of good pictures were on exhibitions about the His Majesty visit of United States that had been played over and over and again, as if that was the solid Thai-U.S. relation. But there are many aspects. So what I try to focus now is take you to the past 60 years and divide into four periods and try to find salient point and look toward the future. Some of the points were touched by the ambassadors and also raised by Dr. Titinan, you know, the texture, the contents, the qualities of Thai-U.S. relation, which I think has been underutilized. I mean, everybody said that Thai-U.S. relation is the U.S. oldest allies in Asia, 180 years old. That's how long it takes, you know, 180 minutes to wait for a visa. You want to promote to people-to-people relation, the first thing is to waive visa. 180 years old, you still have no trust. Actually, Thailand is not bad. There's not much Robin Hood this day. You know, they like to stay in Thailand, just like other who visit Bangkok this day. So the first period is the best period during the 1954 to 1975. That's characterized the real allies because we have common enemy. I repeat, common enemy bring common interest. Now that kind of situation has changed. So Thailand At that time, as you know, until 1975, we host air base for United States. We help United States in wars in Indochina. I don't need to elaborate on that. The second period is from 1975 to the year 2000. Both have made great policy adjustment. Why? Because Thailand has changed its policy. US pulled out from Thailand, like many places in Southeast Asia, for example, the Philippines. But the Thai-US ally was still there, and the focus was on the Indochina, especially on the Cambodian conflicts. I still remember at that time, State Department George Shultz went to the Thai border, you know, after the incursions of the Vietnamese troops. So that kind of good feeling, assurance from the United States still on. But also when I was in high school at the same time, there were a lot of discussion about Paikyo, the dangers from the green uniform. It did not relate to the local green uniform, but some of the inference from abroad. And rightly so. Copper Gold came into existence in 1979. The bilateral annual exercise, which started out very small, very humble, now has become, like the Ambassador Christy said, the world's largest military exercise, involved 27 countries to be exact. And mind you, Thailand has not, I repeat, and it's a very bold statement, has not benefit from Copper Gold in the way it should be, because we have not sent the best people to participate in Copper Gold, particularly from the Supreme Commander. I have to be specific, because it's such a waste of time, such a waste of good cooperation. So the Copper Gold have very good, solid, but benefit other countries that participate. I don't want to mention the country because there are 27, particularly on the amphibious landing. This is actually very important. I don't know why the Thai did not send the best who can speak English. It's dealing this period that a lot of adjustment that Thailand has to do, because from good buddy, from feel good, Uncle Sam, suddenly things had turned around, you know. If you live in Thailand long enough, conversation will pick up some of the points. You know, 1997, America didn't help us. I didn't want to mention the Farm Act. You know, that sort of thing still come back and forth, why the US didn't help us. But I think the past should be bygone. But it come back. That kind of feeling still dictates it, serve as a template for Thai-US relation. And I think we need to move forward, but still we get stuck. And along the way, you know, America is a global power. America has many advisory and friends. Like Thailand, we also make many good friends, and some of the friends are Americans, adversaries. So Thailand is making a lot of adjustments. So it's still very fluid. The third period is the most interesting that mess up the Thai-US relation. It's the year 2000-2006. I call this roller coaster period of Thai-US relation. You see the ups and downs of Thai-US relation. You know, incredible, you know. Thailand as a democracy since 1932, half leave or, you know, one third, whatever it is. US Congress, even at one time, came out with a law, allocate $1 million to promote democracy in Thailand in the year 2003 under Thaksin. And it was that year that Thailand actually has the most active engagement with United States. And I think former President George Bush has a very good relation, has a very good, what do you call, connectedness, you know, rapport with Thaksin. You know, they speak very well, they make many good decisions. Well, many good decisions in the sense that they really change the texture, Dr. Tinan talked about, we enter into a counter-terrorism campaign. We apprehend Hambali, August 2003, and Thailand has been was upgraded to non-NATO ally. And we were very excited, not knowing that it was the last country of the allies to receive such an upgrade. And mind you, Thailand has been complaining since getting this major non-NATO ally that it did not receive any privilege at all on this so-called military hardware procurements. You know, it has upset the Thai military. That's why we look for Sweden, we look for other countries. That was the main reason. Because if America really stick to the non-NATO alliance, given some privilege to Thailand, Thailand would have bought more. So that was the benchmark during these turbulent years. Why I said turbulent years? Because Thailand also turned things around after neutralities in Afghan and Iraq. Thailand joined, knowing full well that we can gain benefit from US, rightly so. The Congress authorized fast track FTA, but it was too fast. Thailand could not handle it. Thai NGO could not handle it. So everything fell flat on the floor. So you're right, Thaksin, because he was the one who really loved this kind of approach with America, and rightly so. We have gained a lot. And Thailand sent the troop to Gabara in October 447. I still remember, after two were killed because of the truck bomb. Thaksin finally shaken out because fearing that, you know, sending the second one will cause more casualties because the situation at that time was worse. So this was the turbulent time. But I must give credits to Thaksin. He was the one who really stimulate, who really gave this strategic trust to Thai US. But unfortunately, he a little bit, you know, focused on his own idiosyncrasy too much, saying want to push ahead without looking at the broad Thai-US relation. The last one before period before I move to the future is after the coup 2006 to the present time. It was downturn of Thai-US relation. You cannot blame the US because of Thai messy politics. The coup in 2006 really served as infamous template for Thai democracy, whatever it is. And unfortunate for APISIT, you know, because after weak governments, previous two-week government, APISIT was able to form a government, but it was not recognized by United States during the 2 years of APISIT government. It was very bad because the relation could have been reinvigorated quickly because Democrat government has some sort of a long view. But unfortunately, there's certain incidents that come in that really upset United States, particularly on the human rights issue, on the Hmong in 2009. And it was interesting why the United States did not understand and push Thailand to the precipice. I mean, the Thai said, hey, listen, we cannot have neighboring country who were mad at us. Cambodia were at Thailand's throat. We didn't want to open another front with Laos. So Thailand made a decision that we have to expat the Laotian Hmong refugee. And rightly so, you look at the Thai-Lao relation now has been very good. And you look at the US-Lao relation has been normalized. The deputy foreign minister has visited. And now there's a lot of activities going on for American missing in action and many other activity. So I think that policy served right. But somehow, a lot of things that come up during APISIT turn against the Thai-US alliance for whatever reason. The NASA project on climate change, the using of Utapau has been politicized, and also until this government. So it's sad because I think all these projects that's come out could turn and give values to the Thai-US alliance, particularly on the ideas of making Thailand as a regional hub for humanitarian assistance and disaster relief. I think that's a very good idea, but you have to blame the Thai Navy because they have such a narrow-minded, they fear that, you know, they will lose out in all this opening up, which I think the Thai Navy needs to review its policy. Having go through all these ups and downs of the 60 years of Thai relation, I have to mention before I proceed to the future is that when Obama came, they came up with a statement, very beautiful statement on Thai-US relation, 1,300 words, and then you have a visions on the joint defense vision of Thailand. They're all great, but if you follow up carefully, nothing has progressed since then. And I was surprised you mentioned Vietnam. The ambassador said that invitation has been given to Yingluck Rack. I don't know whether anyone can confirm that, but there's no fix there. Since 2006, there's no Thai leader visit Washington. And mostly visits unofficial, attend the UN assembly. And this is the oldest relation. Come on, I think US can do better than that. But the problem is US has interest elsewhere. You look at Myanmar, it's a super darling, you know. Thailand feel a little bit, you know, jealous these days, you know. For 65 years, you used to be the one that, you know, everybody looked for, you know. So you just sit still, you know, don't have to do anything. This is why that's the problem, because Thai-US relation has not been reevaluated. It's been very reactive. Thailand has been reactive. That is why the future needs to be more consultative. Now, I have four more points to make. Look into the future. How do you make this Thai-US relation more valuable, more value-added, and also more strategic? We have to get our act together, especially the Thai military. And we have a couple of representatives from here. We have to think strategic. How you think strategic? During the Obama visit, there is a proposal to have 2+2 framework with the participation of the defense and foreign ministry official together. That is a good idea, but it's just an idea. It must be implemented because for a long time, Thailand just act, follow America advice, idea, but never come forward with its own initiative. We need that, and you can only do that with foreign ministry, with defense ministry, sit together, become strategic, because foreign ministry can have strategic view, but the defense ministry said no. Give you an example, during the Thai-Cambodia border skirmish, Thailand offered Indonesia as an observer. The Supreme Commander just simply said no and forget the rest. So this kind of sectorial meeting, sectorial thinking is no longer applicable. It's not very good. So it's very important that we have to get our act together. And I think US realized this, and US has agreed to this formula. And I hope that the 2+2 framework, just like the Philippines, all major strategic partner. If not, you can talk about all these visionary things, you know, about defense. It will not be useful. You need to have the foreign ministry official and defense official sit together with America and work out complete comprehensive strategic relation, and that is very important. And you know, Thailand has already conducted 4 strategic dialogue. Nothing come out. Not to mention our inability of our foreign minister, who cannot speak and communicate with our partner. I have to mention this because this day you need somebody, you need leader who can build up the dialogue. You know, you waste your time. You can visit all the countries, you know, and waste the money, but there is no building block. Secondly, you're talking about all this multidimensional. There's one area that the United States has failed completely, that is trying to reform the Thai security sector. We have to reform the Thai military, help them to be more democratic, help them to be more transparent and accountable. And accountable for their action. And I think this is important. Well, after all, we have many good West Point graduates, and IMED program is penitent this day, 1.3 million. Ridiculous, you know? So I think IMED should be one of the great, great, great program that America should continue to provide money so that the Thai military thinker will broaden their mind. Thirdly, the copper gold is very interesting. I mentioned copper gold and alluded how Thailand did not gain much from all this. Next time, the copper gold make it a requirement that the Thai participation must, number one, speak English. Number two, must come from the top level who can make decisions. And number three, know how to use computer program. And this is very important because many countries benefit from knowledge sharing. I say this specifically because I know what's going on. And there's no assessment of copper gold each year because nobody pay attention in Thailand. I'm sorry, and I would love to hear a different view. So, build up copper gold is great, but make sure Thailand benefit. And Thailand can benefit only if we have an active participation from local military leader. And we have to change the mindset that during the 2 weeks, exercise is not for the promotion of tourism or, you know, increase revenues for tourism. It's the period to learn the interoperabilities of various airlines, how to coordinate work. Number four, during the Obama visit, also Ambassador Christie alluded to, was the idea that Thailand can cooperate with the United States to help the third country. And he mentioned, rightly, Myanmar. But there are other countries in the Mekong River, like, for example, Laos, Cambodia, even Vietnam. And this kind of cooperation is very good, and I think it should be encouraged. And America should be more forthcoming. And I think this is a new area. And actually, Thailand would love to cooperate with America with its relation with other major power. For example, in the case of China, Thailand has a very good relation with China. Thailand also has a very good relation with the US. Since all three have good relation, how can Thailand strengthen their cooperation within the region to ensure peace and stability? This is something new and something that Thailand strategic thinker have not yet spent their time on. And I must say that this is a very urgent issue that the Thai military, the Thai foreign ministry has to make use of this opening. Finally, the last area which I think America missed out is very popular topic. In fact, it's a topic that creates a lot of misunderstanding. That is the promotion of democracy and human rights in Thailand. Thailand is one of the countries that America should be able to do so, but America has done very bad job in promoting democracy and human rights because they speak wrong language all the time. And now Thailand actually has come up with its own human rights report. I remember in 1979, since 1979, as a journalist, I have to use every report come from State Department human rights report at the end of February, you know, to attack Thai record of human rights. Now we don't need to. Nobody cares about human rights report by the State Department anymore. And the Thai came out with much stronger, much more details. And I don't know why. The United States didn't help the local try to validate, try to write human rights, try to promote. But I think during the APISIT time, the United States did not support APISIT because it thought that it was like a demon government, you know, come up, alien come out from this Thai politics. Maneuvering a puppet of the military regime. And this government actually has full support because it's won the election. And the American government actually has ignored a lot of things, you know, maintain, I would describe as a double standard. There are a lot of violations going on under this government, a lot of harassment, intimidation, not only to local people demonstrator, even to the media. So that's how I look at the Thai-US relation. I still have 3 more minutes. Thailand is missing out good time. And Thailand must adjust. Wow, the US ambassador said, well, we have to be flexible. America has to be flexible too in its attitude toward Thailand. Thailand now is completely at a loss. They don't know how to. I mean, it has been how many years already after the rebalancing? Indonesia has adjust. Vietnam, wow, has done great. Look at the Philippines, rejuvenated. They, what do you call, low-level alliance. Now Thailand rank almost as the lowest level. So we need to get our act together because Thai-US relation has a very good ingredients, but we don't have the leadership. We don't have the chef who put it together. We overheated. Thank you.
It's many interesting points. Thank you, Kunkuwi. You know, the Thai military's participation in Cobra Gold, we actually do a good job in PKOs in terms of officer selection and attraction and enticements. But the Cobra Gold is really overlooked. We'll come back to you on many, many points. I'm also interested about the 2000 to 2006 period. This was the high point of US-Thai relations. The last visit was in September 2005. I think the big visit was in June 2003 when Thaksin went to the US and really reshaped the relationship. But then it went astray, it derailed because of domestic politics in Thailand. And now we're trying to regain some footing. Let me move now to John Brandon. John is the Director of International Relations Program at the Asia Foundation. He's a long-standing Thailand, Thai politics analyst, expert, and also on Southeast Asia, on Thai-US relations, a wide gamut. So John, perhaps counter a different view from the American side on the alliance partnership. I mean, what do we do with it? There's a sense of nostalgia. Every time I have this kind of discussion, there's nostalgia that we used to be close allies through thick and thin, but not anymore. And the challenge is to, well, if not anymore, then what do we do with this relationship? How do we take it forward? In what direction? John, please.
Thank you very much, Professor Thitinan, and thank you all for coming. It's a pleasure to be here. I've been to Thailand, I think this is my 5th trip this year for a variety of reasons. Never did I think that I would be coming in January so many times, but it's always nice to be here. Trying to follow up with Kunkuwi is always a hard act to follow, you know, so I will try to do that the best I can. Maybe if I go back, I first came to Thailand in 1978. And when I did, the Vietnam War had just been over. It was still considered somewhat of a special relationship, that this was sort of like the American era in US-Thailand relations. And you had refugees from Vietnam, the Boat people, the year that I arrived. You had Cambodian refugees after the Khmer Rouge were overthrown. You had Lao refugees, and you had ethnic minorities straddling the Thai-Burma border. And so it was Thailand was a real receptacle of other people in this country, and it was a very turbulent time, the height of the Cold War. And so there was, because of Thailand being a strong, committed Cold War ally to the United States, there was this very close and maybe, as some people would describe, special relationship. And when after Ambassador Kennedy, Kenny gave her remarks, and at the end, Professor Tittinghan said to her, he says, well, on an operational level, things seem to be working really well. And I agree with all of that, primarily. But Dr. Tittinghan says, but this is not the old indispensable alliance. And I agree with that as well. And it's, I think, precisely because despite whatever problems Thailand might be experiencing internally now, externally around the country, and even internally then, you had a communist insurgency, that these issues are really no longer the case. I mean, at the time, ASEAN was an anti-communist bloc, would be constantly, and you'd read in the, you know, in the Soviets would call it just sort of like a, you know, ASEAN was a stooge for Americans. It was five countries then. And now you have Vietnam, Cambodia, Laos, you know, who were, you know, who we fought wars with and significant internal strife and conflict. They're all now part of ASEAN, and what you're looking at now is a trading bloc where Thailand, at least in mainland Southeast Asia, but still plays a very critical, can play a critical role in the ASEAN economic community and the integration of that. I personally don't think that ASEAN economic integration is going to be achieved by the end of 2015, but I think that that's that you can at least say that it's moving in that direction. When will that be? Will it be another 2, 3, 5, 10 years? Who knows? But as long as it moves in a positive direction, I think that that's you know, that's a good thing. I always think also, you know, that we talk about this special you know, relationship that you know, that existed. I think after 1975, even though there was still mutual interest because of what was going on in Indochina, that when the U.S. Left, I read this not too long ago, when the U.S. was leaving then South Vietnam. There was a meeting between then Secretary of Defense James Schlesinger and Thailand's foreign minister, who was then Chachai Chunawan. And Secretary Schlesinger said that the United States has a moral obligation to defend Thailand. And apparently, then Foreign Minister Chachai says, the United States does not have any morals at this point. You have already pulled out of Cambodia and South Vietnam, so we're going to depend on ourselves. Now, let's think about that. I mean, you know, all countries act in their own self-interest. And so when there is a synergy, then, you know, you're going to have a close relationship because threats and opportunities are very much in sync. And so at that time, maybe this was I don't want to say the heyday, that's not the right word, but there was this close collaboration. And, you know, with Khun Gawi talking about the four periods over the last 60 years, I would just, I agree with everything. The only thing is I would change the timeline on the second one where you said 75 to 2000. I would have said to 1997, because when the Asian financial crisis came out, I think that was the really, and it emanated from here. It was the first time where people, you know, here Thailand is experiencing this economic meltdown and received what was then the largest bailout in the history of the IMF. And the United States did not come to its defense. Now, there was a reason for that. The reason is that there was something, what happened a couple of years before, there was the Mexican peso crisis. And so when the Clinton administration helped to bail out Mexico, the Congress and then head of the chairman of the Finance Committee, a senator from New York named Alphonse D'Amato, said, we're not going to let any administration do this again, especially you know, the Clinton administration. And so what happened is that it had to receive approval from the Congress, and it was these funds to support it is something called the Economic Stabilization Funds. And so at the time this all happened, there wasn't the political capital in the administration to be able to ask for funds to be bailed out in Thailand. Now, I imagine this had to be explained to Thai policy leaders. Now, they probably didn't want to, they didn't like hearing what they did. It probably wasn't articulated well to the Thai people, even if they didn't like the explanation. And so here, all this time, special relationship, longest uninterrupted relationship in between the United States and any Asian country, a friend, an ally, and what do you do? You don't help us, and so that I think really began where Thais began to look at the United States as being unreliable, and then you had the problem with the. Our involvement in Iraq, and I think a strong public sentiment that people were not pleased with the U.S. Invasion of Iraq. I was here at that came to Thailand and a couple of times in 2003, and there was one trip where I spent a week here, and I spent a week in Vietnam. And to be quite honest, I got an earful here in Bangkok and even up in Chiang Mai. I didn't hear it in Vietnam, which I found really quite astounding. And even meeting with senior officials, maybe that was just a reflection of the improving U.S. Vietnamese relations. So, the bottom line is we all do look in our own special interest. I wanted to try to respond to a couple of other things that people have said, whether it was in the audience or here. There seems to be this. I think the one question that was posed is that the East Asia Summit. Will President Obama come here, after that? And Ambassador Kennedy said the schedule hasn't been finalized, and I certainly understand that she said the right thing. I would be, and this is just a personal view, and all of this is just a personal view, I would be surprised if he did. And but if you look at this, and you look at this effort towards rebalancing, in the last less than 12-month period, President Obama has visited Thailand, Myanmar, Cambodia. He's going to go to Brunei for the East Asia Summit. He's going to Indonesia for the APEC meeting, and he's going for the Global Entrepreneurship Program in Malaysia. And then you've had the Secretary of State and the Secretaries of Defense go to various ASEAN nations that. Both ones that I've said, as well as those that I have not mentioned. And so probably with those senior officials, they may be all 10 countries have been covered. One of the challenges I think to America's rebalancing is precisely what we see in the Middle East, the problems such as in Syria and in Egypt and elsewhere. And that's going to take time and resources. And I think ultimately it's a policy that is I want to see succeed. I think it's in the interest of the United States, and I think it's in the interest of the Asia Pacific region as well. What I would like to see is that, and I think we're beginning to see a little bit of this, is that initially I thought the rebalancing was over-securitized and not enough paid to enough attention paid to trade and economics. That seems to be changing a little bit. But then there's also the question: is that the Trans-Pacific Partnership? There are people who view, and there are people maybe in this room as well as in Thailand who view the TPP as something perhaps maybe is trying to divide ASEAN. And between ASEAN and China, and trying to be able to why not just work towards some type of other free trade agreement with ASEAN. Well, we have a problem with or a challenge with the administration and the Congress. The Congress has to approve any trade agreement. The United States, you know, since 2008, have had a lag in our economic recovery. It's still much better than it was in 2008. Unemployment is still down, but it's still we still have over 7% unemployment. Our budget coffers are, we're looking with sequestration and other cuts that we'll be experiencing, and particularly as we draw down with Iraq and Afghanistan. And you can see even the public sentiment in the U.S., where 3 out of every 4 people are opposed to a strike in Syria. And what does this all mean? And you'll see if you look at CNN or some of the other international television cable stations, you'll see someone standing up in a town hall meeting anywhere in the United States, doesn't matter, East Coast, West Coast, Midwest, Southwest, anywhere, talking about when are we going to start paying attention to our own problems, when our infrastructure, which was considered the best in the world at one time, is now ranked 18th, and we supposedly have 1,000 bridges, big and small, within in the U.S., you know, that are in repair. A couple have collapsed over the last 3 or 4 years. So any time a country gets war-weary, and we are a war-weary nation, You're going to see people want to come home, want to focus on our challenges there. But I think, given despite our challenges right now, politically, economically, the thing that we can't just withdraw. You don't want to see that. I mean, you want to see President Obama come to Thailand again. You know, we're not going to be able to, you know, we're going to somehow have to be able to calibrate what we're going to be able to do to strengthen ourselves at home and to be able to carry out a foreign policy that is effective. And it's going to take time, energy, and resources. And we have to figure that out even through our own domestic challenges. I agree with Khun Goe about U.S.-Thai relations. I think that Thailand really more reacting to U.S. requests as opposed to you know, initiating things, and I think Thailand would be better if it began initiating things more. I mean, it does do things like, you know, trying to, with people-to-people ties. I think in some ways that's ties, and maybe this is just from where I stand in Washington, and you know, I see that the embassy tries to be very active in getting out and doing different things, and there's Thai cultural performances, and it may be the most active of any of the ASEAN countries in that respect, or a lot of other countries as well. And this is a good thing, but there are larger issues, and that gets to terms of trying to expand the people-to-people relationship of students going back and forth. I think what I think it was Ambassador Kenny said that you know, wanting members of parliament go to Thailand, Thai businesses going to the United States, and maybe this is an opportunity now to be able to look at, is that okay? Could we, at a time where ASEAN is looking to integrate economically, and what about the U.S. and other extra regional powers, including China, Japan, Korea, others? How might small and medium-sized enterprises play into this on both sides? What might be done? How might you be able to? I mean, I know small Thai business owners in the United States. How might they be able? Your expatriate community in the United States might help to that endeavor, as well as others who just feel that there's it's natural to and good for to develop U.S.-Thai economic relationships at you know, not just at the, you know, the General Motors, the Ford, or the, you know, the Chevrons of the world. One thing I wanted to mention, Khun Gawi mentioned about you know, we don't give enough money for IMET and for training and all, and I agree with that. It's been a long it's sort of way down from our heyday when the relationship was special. Talking about West Point graduates, but I had a West Point graduate, Thai West Point graduate, once tell me that you know, John, I received a great education at West Point, and but I think that there is somewhat of a reluctance, maybe in Thailand, for people to want to do that, because if you do, and you don't go to Chula Chomklao, where you develop these strong bonds with your classmates, you may get a superb education at West Point, but you may sacrifice the ability to strengthen the Run Diogan, so the old boy ties, that would allow you to move up in the military hierarchy. And so, getting to your point, saying Thailand's not sending their, you know, their best and brightest to Cobra Gold, if maybe that has something to do with it, I don't know, but I just put that out as a, you know, as a question or something to think about. How much time do I have left, or what do you need? 5 minutes. Okay, I won't take that long. I just wanted to make sure I didn't go over. I think the issue of, and this is something that I think I can say as it relates to the Asia Foundation, in terms of trying to strengthen our regional cooperation, I think looking to helping to strengthen the U.S. and Thailand as development partners, where, you know, once Thailand was one of the largest recipients of American foreign aid, and now itself is a donor. Thailand has a very critical place strategically here, and it's in Thailand's security interest. It always has been to see that have a strong, stable, prosperous mainland Southeast Asia, and Southeast Asia more broadly. And so, working with the United States, working with other development partners, I just don't look at it as you know, bilaterally, but if there was a a coordination amongst all donors. Thailand's economy is 4 times larger than Vietnam's, and with, what, 2/3 of Vietnam's population. It's exponentially larger than Myanmar, Laos, and Cambodia. So they, you know, I think in this regard, and in the U.S. effort to want to rebalance, this could be a very important role in helping to strengthen U.S.-Thai relations, but in a very different way from from in the past. So let me end here with saying that, you know, we've heard about the relationship based on historical reasons of it being special. And I think it's fair to be able to ask the question, is it still special? And that can be debated with us up here on the table, all of you and others outside this room in both the U.S. and Thailand in the coming months and years. But even if, let's say, we come to the conclusion that it is not special just because things have evolved, and I think you would look at it as that relations with Thailand in general, despite internal political challenges here, is still a much better place than I think it was in 1978 when I first arrived here. And so maybe it's not special, but don't forget that maybe it was once special. But even if it's not special, if we come to that conclusion, I would like to, I think we can make a strong case to say that it is nonetheless very important and that it's meaningful. And I think it's the responsibility of leaders and the respective governments, as well as people in this room, to try to figure out how to make this relationship more important, meaningful, and if, depending on regional and global trends, perhaps it still retains its specialness. Time will tell. But I thank you, Dr. Tittinan, for inviting me here today. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you.